like the Lord sat there and said in Ezekiel 37, and guess what? We live in a valley of dry bones, man. Right? And who consists of these damn dry bones? Sisters like that that's walking around with no understanding.
Bring it up. That's right.
It's the book of Baruch, chapter 2, and verse 30.
Bring it up.
For I knew that they would not hear me, because it is a stiff-necked people. But in the land of their captivities, they shall remember themselves. That's right. Hey, guess what? We're a stiff-necked people, man. We don't want to sit there, huh?
That's right.
I don't think it's on the
mic. It's on already. Just hit that switch on the mic.
Check, check. All right, cool. Hey, man, so read that one more time. So lucky, King.
This is the book of Baruch, chapter 2 and verse 30. I knew that they would not hear me because it is a stiff-necked people.
No, they heard.
Because it is a stiff-necked people.
They grabbed to the words instantly.
Because it is a stiff-necked people.
That's right. Hey, our people are stiff-necked, man. Right? They sit there and they may turn their eyes over to us just to see what's going on. Hey, what's going on, King? It's madness. It's madness. Hey, you gotta repent and come back to the Most High, King.
That's right.
Right? He sat there and threw up the damn cross, man. But hey, when you sit there and throw that thing up, you actually throwing it up to Lucifer, man. Right? Because, hey, if you sit there and actually follow after what you're doing with the hand gestures, hey, you're making an upside down cross. Exactly, man. Up and down, to and fro. That's what you say? What you say?
That's that up and down, to and fro. When the Lord asked, when the Lord asked Satan what he was doing in the midst of all the sons of God, he was like, "I've been going up and down and to and fro in the earth."
Hey, Khan, just like it says in the book of Job, man, right? Yeah, Job chapter 2. It sat there and said, "Whence comest thou, Satan?" Right, from going up and down and to and fro throughout the earth, man. Right? Hey, that's just like the brother sat there and said. When you sit there and throw that thing up, hey, guess what? You're throwing up an upside down cross, man.
That's right?
It's a lot deeper. They sit there and try to show you these things in Roman Catholicism and damn the Baptist church, right? And they're leading you astray, man. Didn't the Lord sit there and say woe to all the pastors in Jeremiah chapter 16,
right,
man?
Right.
Right, bring that out, man. Somebody bring that out and hold that. What I have you hold, the Baruch 2 and 30? Yeah, Con, I wanted you to kind of finish. Con, bring it up.
The book of Jeremiah, chapter 23, and verse 1. Woe be unto the pastors that destroy and scatter the sheep of my pasture.
That's right. Hey, woe to these damn pastors that sit there and lead our people astray, man. That sit there and tell us, hey, it's okay to eat pork, man. We got grace, baby. Right? All praise to the Most High. You got the damn Edomites slipping and falling, and they can't get up, man. Right? Hey, guess what? They're going to slip and fall, and their kingdom's going to be gone, man. It's going to be lights out for their ass. They're going to wake up and be like, what the hell's going on?
That's right.
Right? And the Lord going to sit there and be, hey, all other nations going to be looking down at Babylon. Oh, Lucifer, how hast thou fallen from heaven, man?
God.
Just like it says in the book of Jeremiah, man. Right? In the snap of a finger, in the blink of an eye, hey, their kingdom going to be snatched away, man.
That's right.
Sweet. Right? On a physical note, everybody's slipping and busting their ass. But, hey, on a spiritual note, hey, this is what's spiritually happening right now. Their kingdom is slipping away, man. Right? We're slowly coming into power, man. Hey, it's grateful times that we're living in right now. Right? The saints are rejoicing right now because we understand that things are getting hot, man. The kitchen is starting to get hot, and we already know that Babylon's... I'm not going to say it like that, but we already know that Babylon's trifling behind is going to sit there and run up out that kitchen when it gets too hot, man.
That's right.
It's getting too hot in that damn kitchen for her to forbear, man. Right? And all the other nations, they sitting there cooking and whipping up these concoctions. Hey, Babylon going to be the first one to sit there and scurry up out of there, man.
No.
Right? They're going to sit there and get Babylon up out of there. They're going to sit there and torture her. Right? They're going to sit there and damn kick her out the kitchen. Then you're going to have the other nations standing. And guess what? The Most High going to sit there and whip up a spiritual concoction and the whole kitchen going to blow up, man. Right? And then, hey, all the nations of the earth going to sit there and be no more, man. All the other nations of the earth, they're going to be no more. And guess what? They're going to sit there and be getting ready for slavery, man. That's what's going to be going down. Hey, what's going on, King? Come out at me real quick. You see yourself on this sign right here? You see yourself on this sign? Anybody else? Y'all could go ahead and look. Y'all see yourself on this sign right here? Oh, praise. Yeah, you be from the tribe of Judah, man.
That's right.
Right? You know who else from the tribe of Judah, King? Let me get Hebrews 7 and 14, man. Right? I'm going to tell you something you never heard before, more than likely. Do you believe that so-called Jesus Christ is a white man? Do you believe he's a dark-skinned man just like brothers up here? Okay, all right. All right, so let's go ahead and build the foundation. Let's lay it down, man.
This is the book of Hebrews, chapter 7 and verse 14. For it is evident that our Lord sprang out of Judah.
That's right. Hey, our Lord and Savior sprang out of the tribe of Judah. And we know that Judites, right, children from the tribe of Judah typically look like our complexion.
Right,
brown and darker. Right? So therefore, our Lord and Savior, he was not a so-called white man with blue eyes and dog stringy hair. He looked like us. He was a so-called black man. Right? Let me get Daniel chapter 7 and verse 9.
The book of Daniel 7 and verse 9. I beheld till the thrones were cast down, and the Ancient of Days did sit.
Right, the Ancient of Days did sit. Who is the Ancient of Days? That is the Most High God. Because he has no time. He has no age. He is Ancient of Days, man.
Whose garment was white as snow.
Hey, so the Most High God, hey, guess what? He's not just a puff of smoke. He's not a gust of wind. He wears a white garment. So therefore, hey, didn't it say that we were made in the likeness of our God? Right, man was made in the likeness of his image. So therefore, hey, the Most High God is a man figure himself. Read on.
And the hair of his head like a pure wool.
Right, so who has woolly hair, King? Our people, man. Exactly, right? The Negroes, Hispanics, and Native Americans got woolly textured hair, man. Right? So read on. Finish that out.
Reading on. It said, white as snow, and the hair of his head like a pure wool. His throne was like the fiery flame, and his will as burning fire.
Right, and this is talking about the angels that was round about him. Now, so we understand that the Most High God, he's a man-like figure. He's not just a puff of smoke. Right, and he also had hair as to the pure wool. Who's the only people on earth that has hair to the pure wool? We just sat there and said, the natives and Hispanics and blacks. Right, so bring out Revelations 1 and 13. Now we're going to get the depiction, start at 1 and 1. We're going to get the depiction of our Lord and Savior, what Jesus, so-called Jesus Christ, actually looks like. It's the book of Revelation, chapter 1 and verse 1. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him to show unto his servants, things which must shortly come to pass. And he sent it and signified it by his angel unto his servant John.
I will.
It's the book of Revelation, chapter 1 and verse 13. And in the midst of the seven candlesticks, one like unto the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to the foot, and a girdle about the path with a golden girdle. His head and his hairs were white like wool. All right, here we go again. Now, our Lord and Savior also had woolly hair, right? Because whatever your father is, so are you. As pursuing the Numbers chapter 1 and verse number 18, there's no such thing as let me get that real quick. There's no such thing as biracial. There's no such thing as, I'm mixed with X, Y, and Z. Hey, whatever your father is, that's the same thing that you are. We're going to prove it through the Bible. Did you know that, King? All right.
Numbers 1 and 18. And they assembled all the congregation together on the first day of the second month. And they declared their pedigrees after their families by the house of their fathers.
That's right. So therefore, whatever your father is, that's the same thing you would be. If your father was a so-called black man, you would be a so-called black man. If your father was a Hawaiian man, you would be a Hawaiian man. Right. And that's just what it is. Right? The Lord sat there and set up all these things. But read on to that real quick. His head and his hairs were white like wool, right, as white as snow, and his eyes was a flame of fire. That's right. Hey, so guess what? The Lord didn't have blue eyes. His eyes were red as to the flame of fire. Right? So that's another thing. That's another strike. If we was playing baseball right now, hey, guess what? We'd be on the second strike right now. Right? And his feet like unto fine brass, as if they burned in a furnace. And that would be the third strike right there. It sat there and said that our Lord and Savior had feet as into fine brass, as if they burned in a furnace. Oh. You throw anything in a furnace, what color is going to turn? It's going to turn black, man. It's going to get dark. it's gonna look like charcoal.
Right.
Right? Hey, it's not gonna sit there and look like the damn, we don't got the, where's the posters at? Oh, it's locked. Right?
It's on the card.
It's not gonna, he's not gonna look like this, man. Where's it at?
Right.
He's not gonna look like this. Damn Cesar Borges, man. Right? That's who this is right here. This is Cesar Borges, man. Right? And you can read about him. You can read a small account about him in Wisdom of Solomon chapter 14. Man.
That's right.
Right? A father afflicted with untimely mourning. Hey, he sat there and made a picture of his son to be worshipped. Right? And our people, we sit there and bow down before, hey, this damn devil right here. And the term devil means deceived.
Right.
Right? So therefore, when I'm sitting there calling him a devil, hey, he's a deceiver. Right? Why? Because, hey, guess what? They sat there and tried to say that our Lord and Savior looks like that, but we just read in Revelation chapter 1 and verse 13 that he looked like a so-called black man. Right? So therefore, now we got to sit there and understand, what else are they lying to us about in this damn Bible, man?
Right.
Right? Let me get Zechariah chapter 11 and verse number 5, and somebody hold Esther chapter 7 and verse number 4.
No, Zechariah 11 and 5.
Wait, no, she got one.
You got a flyer right there, King, with our information on it too. With the, you got the YouTube on there, you got the email on there, so just in case you got to slip away, whatever the case may be, at least you still got the, you know, the wisdom and information that you need.
Bring that out.
It's the book of Zechariah, chapter 11, and verse 5.
Right.
All right, hold on. You could get a flyer if this pertains to you, right? We'll start at verse 4. Thus saith the Lord my God, be the flock of the slaughter, whose possessors slay them. Now hold on, hold on. It said, feed the flock of this of his slaughter, man. Right? What typically moves in flocks, in herds?
Sheep,
exactly. Let me get Matthew chapter 15 and start at verse number 24.
Bring it up, bring it up.
Matthew
chapter 15 and verse 24.
Bring it up.
But he answered and said, I am not sent but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel.
No, everybody.
Of the house of Israel.
White man.
Of the house of Israel.
Asian man.
Of the house of Israel. Hey, the Lord's not sent but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel. So therefore, if you're not on this sign, you're not an Israelite.
Bring it up.
Right? The whole Bible is literally only written to the Israelites.
That's
Did you know that, King? I sat there and told you, you're going to come up here and learn something you never heard before, man. Right? So read on in that in Zechariah chapter 11 and verse number 5. I want you to sit there and tell me if this fits our people. Yay or nay? Feed the flock of the slaughter.
I'm there.
Oh, okay. Whose possessors slay them and hold themselves not guilty. Right? So who gets gunned down in the street every 48 hours unarmed? Exactly. Right? Read on. And they that sell them say, blessed be the Lord, for I am rich, and their own shepherds pity them not. Right? Hey, guess what? And who says that? Our damn enemies, our oppressors, man. The damn white man that walks around every single day and sits there and says, hey, I get to go home to my family with paid leave after they done sat there and slaughtered an unarmed black man.
Right?
Right? That didn't do not a damn thing, man. Right? Look at Trayvon Martin. Right? Look at damn Aubrey. What's his name? Last name? Jamal Aubrey? Ahmaud Arbery, who sat there and got lynched in broad daylight by three men, right? Hey, these are the things that we have to deal with on a consistent basis, man. Let me get Esther chapter 7 and verse 4. I got something else to link up with that.
Book of Esther 7 and 4, and it reads, for we are sold, and I, my people, to be... For we are sold, I and my people, to be destroyed, to be slain and to perish.
What is that right there, King? That's being sold to be destroyed.
That's right.
To sit there and perish off of the face of the earth, man.
That's right.
Right? They weren't doing that just to sit there and show us how much compassion and love they had towards us.
Oh.
Right? They did that to sit there and literally mentally destroy us to the point where we can't even capacitate, hey, who we are, what things that we're supposed to keep, what we're supposed to do as a people. Right? We don't even know who we are anymore. Let me get Jeremiah 17 and 4, man. And finish that out in Esther chapter 7.
To be slain and to perish. But if we have been sold for bond men and bond women, I had held my tongue, although the enemies could not countervail the king's damage.
That's right, man. Hey, we were sold for bond men and bond women. It's plain upon table. Who else went into slavery? Nobody else went into slavery but us as a people.
That's right.
Nobody else could sit there and say that they were shackled on the bottom of cargo slave ships, right, to the point where they was damn bunched up together, right, peeing on themselves, right, pooping on each other and everything like that. Only us as a people went through that. And our forefathers. Bring it out, King. It's the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 28 and verse 68. And the Lord shall bring thee into Egypt. Right, I'm going to just give you a little history lesson real quick, right? So in the times of Egypt, we were in slavery underneath Pharaoh Ramses.
That's right.
Right? So therefore, we were serving with hard rigor and bondage and labor. So when it's going into Egypt right now, hey, that word in the Hebrew translates to Egyptos, which translates to bondage. What's bondage? Slavery. Right? So therefore, we understand that, okay, it's saying that we should go into slavery again. Right? Read on. And the Lord shall bring thee into Egypt again, into slavery again, right? And this is after the times of Exodus. Therefore, we've already been delivered out of the place of Egypt. So now, read on. With ships. Well, how did we get over here to this landmass? Exactly. This is prophesied 3,000 plus years ago in the Bible of something that came to pass shortly about 1,000 years ago, right? Where we was sitting there, where we was delivered from the transatlantic slave trade from the land of West Africa over here to a landmass which we didn't know.
That's right.
Right? Read on. By the way whereof I spake unto thee, thou shalt see it no more again. We should never see our homeland again, right? Because what's our homeland? We don't know. We sit there and call ourselves Negroes, Blacks, African Americans, right? We can't sit there and go to any of those places as a landmass. If you sit there and go to the airport and say, I want to go to the land of Negro, they're going to look at you crazy. You say, I want to go to the land of Black, they're going to look at you crazy. You say, I want to go to the land of Africa, America, hey, guess what? They're going to look at you crazy. It's two different damn continents, man. Right, read on. Thou shalt see it no more again, and there ye shall be sold unto your enemies. Right, it sat there and said we'd be sold unto our enemies. Right, who were we sold unto? Exactly. So therefore, what the Lord called them? The Lord called them what, though, in this scripture that we just read? Our enemies.
Right.
Therefore, we shouldn't be walking hand in hand with our oppressors and our enemies, man. Because everything's not sweet. Right? Let me get Isaiah... never mind, drop that. Right, read on that. And there ye shall be sold unto your enemies, for bond men and bond women, and no man shall buy you. Right, and no man has redeemed us out of slavery. Why? Because only the Lord can do it.
Right.
Right? No man on a carnal level can sit there and get us out of the slavery that we're in right now.
That's right.
Right, we're still in slavery. It just sat there and said, I translated Egypt for you. Right? I told you it means slavery. And it said we were going to slavery on ships.
Right.
Now, we're still in slavery as a people. We came out of shackles and chains on a physical level, but on a spiritual level and on a mental level, hey, guess what? We're still in chains and shackles.
Right.
Let me get Baruch chapter 3 and verse 8. It's the book of Baruch chapter 3 and verse 8. Behold, we are yet this day in our captivity, where thou hast scattered us for a reproach and a curse, and to be subject to payments according to all the iniquities of our fathers. Right, according to all the iniquity of our fathers. Right? What's iniquity? Iniquity, ultimately is sin. Right? What is sin? Let me get 1 John chapter 3 and verse number 4. Right? And hold that. But it just sat there and said, we are yet this day in our captivity. Right? How are we in captivity? We gotta pay taxes to the damn so-called white man, right? They get a portion of every single thing that we sit there and try to obtain, man.
That's right.
We gotta get everything from them, like it says in the book of Deuteronomy 28:48, right? Bring that out real quick. Yeah, is it 45? Come. Let me get 28:45 of Deuteronomy.
Deuteronomy 28 and 45.
Yo.
Moreover, all these curses shall come upon thee, and shall pursue thee and overtake thee till thou be destroyed, because thou hearkenest not unto the voice of the Lord thy God to keep his commandments and his statutes which I command thee this day.
Right, so therefore all of these things are happening to us because we didn't keep the Most High God's charge and commandments, the laws and statutes. So therefore, what do we have to do in order to get out of this slavery and captivity that we're living in right now? We got to keep the Most High God's commandments.
That's right.
Because that's exactly how we ended up in this position. That's exactly how we ended up not knowing who we are as a people.
Right.
Right. So let me leave you with a couple of commandments real quick, King. Let me get Joshua chapter 22 and verse number 5 and then get the brothers some commandments, man. Right. Because it's the whole reason why we up here. I gave you a little history lesson. I gave you a breakdown and some understanding of who you are according to the Bible now. Right. Actually, no, I didn't. Let me get Deuteronomy chapter 29 and verse number 1 real quick.
Deuteronomy 29 and verse 1. These are the words of the covenant which the Lord commanded Moses to make with the children of Israel.
Right, and just like we read in Matthew chapter 15 and verse number 24, the Lord is not sent but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel. So therefore, we know that this Bible is only written to the Israelites. And all the things that I just sat there and broke down to you, and that you now have a new understanding for, right? Who would you be according to the Bible now with this understanding that I have broke down to you? You'd be an Israelite, King, from the tribe of Judah, right? And what tribe was you from? I didn't understand. I didn't get your tribe. Simeon, all praises, right? So you'd be a so-called Dominican. Your father would be... You're black? Oh, okay, so you'd be from the tribe of Judah, King. Right? So y'all brothers will both be from the tribe of Judah, man. Your father's a so-called black man. All praise to the Most High, man. So y'all just learned something new, man. Right? Y'all understand who y'all are according to the Bible, man. And not only according to the Bible, but who you are as the people just in general. Because Negroes, blacks, and African-American, those are just bywords that are placed upon our people.
Oh, right.
Africa is the last name of a so-called white man. Right? Leo Scipio's Africanus. Right, who conquered the land of Ham and the Punic Wars and named the landmass after himself. And then you had Amerigo Vespucci, right, which named the landmass America after himself, which was an Italian map maker and sat there and pretty much, and like I just sat there and said, he named the landmass after himself.
Right.
We call ourselves after the last name of two so-called white men. Why? Because of a damn coon that sat there and decided, hey, they sit there and come from Africa, and they're living in America right now, so let's just call them African Americans. And he sat there and kind of slapped his knee, ha ha, right? But hey, we're still sitting there calling ourselves these things,
right?
Which is truly nothing, right? It's not our true nationality. We've been cut off from our heritage, right? So therefore, let me get Joshua 22 and 5, and we're gonna get you some commandments.
Joshua 22 and verse 5.
You know,
but take diligent heed to do the commandments and the law which Moses, the servant of the Lord, charged you, to love the Lord your God and to walk in all his ways.
Let me get 1 John chapter 5 and verse number 3. Because it sat there and told us to take diligent heed and to love the Lord our God and to follow after his ways. How do we love the Most High God? Do you know, King? All right, let's bring it out for the brother. Right? That's why we're up here, man. Right? We're casting down the strongholds and we're ripping back that veil that Babylon has put upon our people.
That's right.
Right? The book of 1 John chapter 5 and verse 3.
Yo.
For this is the love of God,
right,
that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not grievous. That's right. Hey, so we got to keep the Most High God's commandments to express our love unto him. Right? So therefore, read on.
To love the Lord your God and to walk in all his ways and to keep his commandments.
There it goes again. Right? Not only do we have to love him by keeping his commandments, it tells us again, hey, just to sit there and make sure it's reinstated, man. Right? Just to make sure it's reinforced because it's that important.
And to cleave unto him and to serve him with all your heart and with all your soul.
Right, so this is a weighty matter right here, because it sat there and said we gotta cleave unto him. And cleaving is not just you kinda just grab it. No, you kinda holding tight. Hey, you could sit there and an airplane could damn take off. You still holding on tight, man. You kinda blowing in the wind, but you're still holding on. You're cleaving, man.
No.
That's what that goes into, right? And therefore, we follow after the Lord our God, and we we give our life and our soul unto him, man. Right? That's what the Lord literally commands of us. To keep the Most High God's commandment and his charge, man. What precept you got?
I want to get the brother some commandments before he head out. Khan, let me get some commandments real quick. I'm going to give you like 3 commandments and I'm going to let you be on your way.
The book of Leviticus, chapter 19 and verse 27.
No.
Ye shall not round the corners of your heads, neither shalt thou mar the corners of thy beard.
Right, so do you know what that's going into? All right, so it said you should not round the corners of your heads. That's going into making your head bald. Right, like Tyrese or Michael Jordan. Right, and who else?
Ray Allen.
Floyd Mayweather, Birdman. Who you say, King?
Ray Allen,
right? We can't make our head bald. We can't damn take a razor blade and then just sit there and take the shaving cream and just decide, oh yeah, I'm gonna go bald today. Right? No, we can't do those things. The Lord told us specifically not to do that.
Right.
And we can't mar, which means destroy our beard.
Right.
So therefore, you can't push back that natural line that you have of your beard. You got to let it grow in.
Right.
And you can't shave it off. You can't stand to make sure you got a goatee. Hey, brothers grow what they could grow up here, man.
Right.
Right? If brothers sit there and they got mighty beards, hey, that's of the Most High. And if brothers kind of got stubble and they struggling, hey, that's of the Most High too. The Most High is the author of all things, right?
Right.
So therefore, hey, you got to sit there and grow what you could grow. That's what the Lord told us. Read on. The book of Numbers, chapter 15 and verse 37. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel, and bid them that they make them fringes and the borders of their garments. Right? So do you know what fringes are, King? Yeah, it is a part of clothing, but it actually goes at the end of your shirt or your garment. Right? All the brothers up here got them on. Right? Some brothers got gold, some brothers got black and silver, some brothers got, you know, hey, silver over there. Right? Those are fringes right there. Right? And we're going to tell you why we got to wear them. And the borders of their garments throughout their generation, which means forever, and that they put upon the fringe of the borders a ribbon of blue. See, everybody has a ribbon of blue above their fringes as well. Right? So read on. Because blue was a royal color, right? Blue and purple in ancient times was a royal color. It was very hard to sit there and pretty much brew that up. And it shall be unto you for a fringe, that ye may look upon it and remember all the commandments of the Lord and do them. That's right. So there's 613 laws, statutes, and commandments all throughout the Bible. Right? Now, we kind of leaving you with about 3. I want Leviticus chapter 11 and verse. Start at verse number... No, you could just start at 7.
Leviticus 11 and 7.
No.
And the swine, though he divide the hoof and be cloven footed, yet he cheweth not the cud. He is unclean to you.
Right, so do you know what the swine is, King? Yeah, that's the pig, man.
Right.
And it just sat there and said it's unclean unto
right.
us.
Right.
Right, because why? It doesn't digest its food properly. It cheweth not the cud.
God.
Right, so it doesn't digest its food. You got the cow that has about a digestive process that takes a couple of hours, a plethora of hours, right? Because they have about 3 different, they have 3 stomachs, right? And they sit there and digest their food properly. Therefore, the cows are, I know, the cow is clean to us, right? But the pig, hey, guess what? It's unclean to us.
Right.
Because why? They don't properly digest their food, nor do they sweat, right? They don't have any sweat glands. So therefore, all the toxins that are within them, hey, it just kind of builds up. And then when we sit there and damn cut them up and eat them, hey, we're eating up all the toxins and all the stuff that they sit there and eat up. And they eat anything, right? They eat their own feces. They eat them, the waste or whatever the case may be back in the day. And guess what? They used to let pigs run rampant instead of having the garbage trucks. Because then guess what? We didn't have that at that time, man. But the pigs would sit there and tear up anything that sat there and got dropped.
Right.
So therefore, the Lord told us, hey, it's unclean. We can't eat those things. Finish that up.
Verse 8, of their flesh shall ye not eat, and their carcass shall ye not touch.
Right, so the dead pig, you can't touch it. So that pork that's sitting in the superstore, hey, don't touch it, because you're going to be unclean. Right, read on.
They are unclean to you. Verse 9, these shall ye eat of all that are in the waters, whatsoever have fins and scales, in the waters and the seas and the rivers, them shall ye eat.
Right, so do you know a couple of things that have fins and scales that are in the waters? Yeah, fish, but what type of fish? Because not every type of fish is clean. Yeah, it's a whole bunch.
You just try to name one.
Catfish is the one that is unclean. Because it doesn't have fins and scales. Now it has scales. But when you pick up something like a bluegill, or you pick up something like cod, or salmon, or tilapia, hey, they have fins and scales, so therefore they're clean. Right? Shrimp, crab, lobster, those are other things that don't have fins and scales. They don't have fins nor scales. Right? And they're bottom feeders of the damn sea. They eat up all the feces. They do the same thing as the pig. Right? When you look at, yeah, you can't eat the pork. Right? Yup. We talk about the fringes. And there's one more. Yup. The hair. Yup. You can't make your head bald and you can't shave your beard. Right? So do you shave your beard, Kane?
Oh, yeah. Fucking hell.
Okay, alright, all praise. Until now, that's a mighty act, man. Right, so therefore you gotta let your beard grow out. Right, let me get Matthew 19 and 16. Then I'm gonna get 2 Chronicles 7 and 14. I'm gonna leave you with these.
Right, the same Matthew, chapter 19 and verse 16. Bring it up. And it reads thus, and behold, one came and said unto him, good master, what good thing shall I do that I may have eternal life? And he said unto him, why callest thou me good? There is none good but what? That is your hell. But if thou wilt enter into life, keep the commandments.
Right, so in order to get eternal life, in order to get the kingdom of heaven, the Most High God sat there and told us to keep the commandments.
Right.
Just like I read to you earlier. So now, what do we have to do as well? Let me get Acts 17 and 30, and I'm going to get this last precept for y'all.
Acts 17 and 30.
No!
And in the times of this ignorance, God winked at.
Right, so in the times where we did not know where we were going off, where we were sinning, where we were transgressing the law because we didn't necessarily have it, we didn't have knowledge of it, the Lord sat there and said he winked at it. What does that mean? Hey, he just kind of, you know, shoot it. Why? Because, hey, guess what? He told us to repent. And what's the act of repentance? We're going to get into that. Finish it up.
But now commandeth all men everywhere to repent.
Right, so the Most High God told us, hey, look, you know what I'm saying? I forgive you of your sins that you committed. You were ignorant to it. You didn't know. Right? That's a fair thing to do. The Most High God is a fair man. He's a just man. And he shall not lie. Right? So therefore, he sat there and said, hey, just make sure you repent and come back to me. Start keeping my law, statutes, and commandments. How do we repent? Let's get into 2 Chronicles 7 and 14.
It's the book of 2 Chronicles chapter 7 and verse 14. If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sins and will heal their land.
That's right. So we got to call upon the Most High God. How do you do that? You pray to him, right? You seek him in prayer. You seek him in fasting, right? And you call upon the name of the Lord, right? And then you sit there. We get Psalms 83 and verse number 18, because you got to know the Most High God's name too. But I just wanted to let you know how to repent, because you've committed sins and transgressions and iniquity, but now you got to call upon the Most High God and repent. Right, because, hey, just like I said in Acts 17 and 30, now I command all men everywhere to repent. And that's how you clean yourself. That's how you clean your spiritual garment. Because now you're coming out of darkness into light. You're coming out of the world where, hey, your garment was filthy. It had all types of abominations and stains on it. You had ketchup stains on it. And the Lord sat there and said that our garment should be white. White as snow, man. Right? Once you want to sit there and look, don't they sit there and say, hey, godliness is cleanliness is next to godliness, right? That's the saying that they say, right? So therefore, hey, you want to sit there and be as clean as possible, right? And sit there and have a garment like unto the Most High God. Just like we read in Daniel 7 and 9, hey, he had an all-white garment, right? So therefore, hey, guess what? You want to have that same type of garment. Why? Because you're next to godliness. Right? So therefore, hey, you understand who you are according to the Bible now. You know what commandments you got to keep. Hey, so you got to take diligent heed to that thing. Let me get Psalms 119 and verse number 60, I believe. Right?
Book of Psalms, chapter 119 and verse 60. And it reads...
Lucky, there's not a 60.
Oh, yeah, it's 59. The book of Psalms, chapter 119 and verse 59. I thought of my ways and turned my feet unto thy testimonies. I made haste and delayed not to keep thy commandments.
That's right. So we got to make haste in this thing, right? So now you understand the three commandments or four commandments, really about five, that we sat there and broke down to you. Now you got to make haste in keeping those commandments.
That's right.
Right? And so also there's a significance about today. Do you know what today is? All right. Let me get Exodus chapter 20 and 8. It's the book of Exodus chapter 20 and verse 8. Remember the Sabbath day. Right, today is the Sabbath day, if you did not know. Right? Hey, so what's the Sabbath day? Hey, guess what? This is a day dedicated to the Lord. Right, where we can't buy or sell. Right, we can't necessarily kindle a fire. Right, to cook anything. Now you gotta pretty much prep your food throughout the week for today. So therefore, hey, you gotta sit there and make some sandwiches, maybe put some chips to the side or whatever the case is, to make sure, hey, you're ready for the Sabbath day. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work. But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it thou shalt not do any work. That's right. So therefore, we're not to do any servile work in the Sabbath day.
Right.
Why? Because we're supposed to be dedicating this day to the Most High God. Right. So if y'all got a schedule, if you on a clock, right, or on schedule for a Friday night to Saturday night, and you got to sit there and kind of tell your boss, say, look, it's a Sabbath day. You know, you can kind of get off a religious exemption because you can sit there and pretty much tell them, hey, guess what? This is what I believe in now. Hey, I'm an Israelite. According to the Bible, hey, I got to keep the Most High God's commandments. I can't come in on the damn Sabbath day.
Right.
Because the Lord told me specifically not to. Right. And there's punishments that come. Hey, let me get Nehemiah chapter 10 and verse 29.
Hey, sir, you got to go kind of with my family. Right?
No doubt, no doubt. Alright, King. No doubt. You can read that on the way.
Nehemiah.
Yeah.
The book of Nehemiah, 10 and 19.
10 and 29, I believe. It's the book of Nehemiah, chapter 10 and verse 29. They claimed to their brethren, their nobles, and entered into a curse and to an oath to walk in God's law. Salakia, I don't want to gather the sticks on the Sabbath day.
Are you talking about, Numbers chapter 35?
Yeah, you can get that too, but it's Nehemiah as well.
Oh.
Let me get Numbers chapter 36.
Numbers 15, verse
32. Yeah. That's what I said, but... Oh, Con, it's 10 and 31.
The book of Numbers, chapter 15, and verse 32. And it reads,
Rocket, my hands get cold. Chicago. I was not wet.
The book of Numbers, chapter 15, and verse 32. And it reads, Salakia, this is the book of Numbers, chapter 15, and verse 32. And while the children were in the wilderness, they found a man that gathered sticks upon the Sabbath day. And they found him gathering sticks. And they that found him gathering sticks brought him unto Moses and Aaron, unto all the congregation. And they put him inward, because it was not declared what should be done unto him.
Right, so you had a man that was gathering sticks on the Sabbath day. And they pretty much held him captive until his trial came about. Right? Hey, there was a judgment that he had to pay for gathering sticks on the Sabbath. Why? Because you're not supposed to be working.
Right.
Read on.
And the Lord said unto Moses, the man shall surely be put to death.
Right.
And all the congregation shall stone him with stones.
Hey, and that's his judgment right there, man. He got put to death, man, for gathering sticks on the Sabbath day.
Yeah.
Because that's a serious offense to the Most High God. The Most High God sat there and gave us a day to rest. Right? A day to dedicate unto him. And guess what? We took of it and decided, hey, we're going to sit there and lay up cares for this world.
Right.
We're going to sit there and clock the overtime, man, and sit there and try to get that little extra $40, $50, man, on our paycheck, man. Right? Hey, the Most High God is not getting down with damn overtime on the damn Shabbat, man.
Right.
That's madness. Right? Because essentially you're just laying up riches for this world, man. Right? The Lord will sit there and provide for you, man. Right? You keep your faith in the Lord, he shall sustain thee, man. He shall keep the feet of his saints, roughly paraphrasing like in the book of Psalms says. Right? Hey, so therefore, hey, you seen your nationality up here, King?
Yeah,
I know you've been standing up here for a little minute. You was kind of hearing a little bit what was going on. Negro, all right, so you be from the tribe of Judah, King, right? You be from the mighty tribe of Judah. I'ma bring out these two precepts, and I'ma let the next brother sit there and bring it out. All right, let me get Zephaniah chapter 1 and verse number 14, and then let me get Genesis 49 and 1. Come. Hey, man, all praises to the Most High, man. All these damn Edomites are slipping and falling, man, right? And they losing their kingdom, man. Hey, it's all on a spiritual note, man.
Right.
Just like I said earlier, hey, guess what? They slipping and falling on a physical note, and they kind of getting up. But, hey, they going to slip and fall on a spiritual note, and they ain't going to get back up, man.
Right.
Let me get that Zephaniah 1 and 14. It's the book of Zephaniah, chapter 1 and verse 14. The great day of the Lord is near. Oh, it's far. The great day of the Lord is near. It is near and hasteth greatly, even the voice of the day of the Lord. The mighty man shall cry there bitterly.
No, shall be strong.
The mighty man shall cry there bitterly.
Read on.
That day is a day of wrath,
right.
A day of trouble,
right.
And distress, a day of wasteness and desolation, a day of darkness and gloominess, a day of clouds and thick darkness,
right.
A day of the trumpet and alarm against the fenced cities and against the high towers. I will bring distress upon men that they shall walk like blind men because they have sinned against the Lord, and their blood shall be poured out as dust and their flesh as the dung. Hey, man, so that's the destruction coming to the earth right now in these last days, man, right? Hey, the blood of damn Esau and all these damn other nations, and guess what? Two-thirds of our people as well are going to be poured out as the dust, man, and their flesh as the dung. Right? So you got to get right with the Most High while you got time, man. Because, hey, guess what? It's going to be a season. It's going to be a time and place where, hey, you can't get right with the Most High no more, man. You're going to be on his bad side. Right. Bring that on Genesis 49.
Genesis 49 and verse 1.
You know.
And Jacob called unto his sons and said, gather yourselves together.
Stay home.
Gather yourselves together.
Kick up and relax.
Gather yourselves together. That I may tell you that which befall you in the last days.
Right, and you're living in the last days, man.
That's right.
Right? You got damn World War III about to kick off at any given moment, man. You got destruction on the rise, pestilence, fear, famine, right? All these things coming onto the earth right now, man.
Right.
Right? So get right with the Most High while you got time. Seek him while he may be found, man. And with that, I want to say, Kum Yashalom.
Kum Yashalom.
Kum Yashalom. And I'm going to pass it to the next powerful speaker, and he's going to edify it in ways that I couldn't, man.